Hi everyone, this is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 27 of the BusinessX learning series, Invest, Scale, Value and Exit. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali, and welcome friends and welcome to another edition. If you're joining this month the first time, very, very happy new year to you. This is our regular edition on Saturday afternoon, just about 30 odd minutes, where we spend about 20-25 minutes on giving you one topic on a particular aspect. It can be on value, exit, scale, and how do you really do any of these things in the cycles of your business. So we talk about that. And then maybe 10 minutes, a little more interactive, your questions. So if you have any questions, you would have to go to a Q&A box and start asking your questions. And I'll probably spend more time in answering your questions today. So today's topic is about mentorship. You know, so a lot of these days, I mean, startups come to us and especially on a BusinessX platform where they would seek that, should I take a mentor? Should I not take a mentor? Which kind of mentor is required to be done? People share their experiences of different kind of mentoring programs they've gone through. They've gone very institutional mentoring programs, or they've just gone with one mentor which has taken them, helped them in terms of doing it. I can tell you there are a lot of good case studies on that, and there's enough and more data available. You should really lead. If you are a startup or starting your own business or planning to start your own startup, I think you need a mentor. Even if you are doing a business which has some kind of history, like in franchise, even if you are doing a franchise business where you are tying up with the already established brand, it's still not a bad idea to have a good mentor. Because still it's a startup, it will still have its own challenges. And if you are somebody who's not done business in the past, you would need to take a mentor. And so what we're going to cover today's topic is why you require a mentor. As I said, I mean, I'll go into detail in terms of what is the real impact of being mentors around and why we need it. Then we'll also talk about types of mentors available, you know, what kind of mentor you should choose. I always believe it's much easier for a mentor to choose a mentee than a mentee to choose a mentor. It's actually the other way around. People think that getting a good mentor is difficult. Actually, that's easier. But for a founder or a company, the business owner to really go out and say, this is a mentor who's going to help me out and I'm going to be staying with him for many, many, many years and probably have a long, deeper association and share whatever my challenges are and open up my everything to this mentor is a very important decision. It's like you're choosing your Dronacharya. It's something which is very, very difficult for somebody to do that. It's like, choosing your, Krishna. So anybody in our mythology also, there is a very big importance of a mentor. And mentors really have to also see through, and there has to be a collective bonding. Unless and until that is there, this would not last and you will not be able to get results, and it actually can become bitter. I've seen people who are talking and giving that this is my mentor at the particular stage, and later they are not doing it, and because there was a mismatch of expectation. So we'll talk about types of mentors. We'll also talk about the stages where you need a mentor. At what are the stages? And business is also self-evolving. You know, different stages, different mentors would be able to guide you through. I'll also talk about the 9 reasons why mentors would work. What are the key impact areas they would really work on that? 3 areas which I will talk about. What is the objective of a mentorship program? You know, what kind of objectivity you need to bring in? You need to be very firm on that. That these are 3 or big objectives. And I think these are 3 big objectives which a mentor should really look at. And finally, how to select the right mentor, who should really you go out and select the right mentor, and how you are creating a long-term value creation. Because a mentor at the certain stage was a fancy word. You know, everybody wanted to be a mentor. People like that in that situation. They start the programs and then they fall that it's asking a lot of time from them and a lot of commitment from them. And that's where they start pulling them back. So I've realized that unless and until you have a very defined role, it's just not done because somebody has become very successful and now wants to do a mentor, other young people, or you just for the sake of it, getting a great name who is looked like your mentor would not make sense. I think either side of that would not create any kind of a value. So how do you really be able to define that is very important. So we will start with first understanding why you need a mentor, why you need guiding. And mentorship is not for everyone. I've seen a lot of successful people started their program and started doing mentorship with the young people, young founders, and they had no impact on the businesses because it needs a lot of commitment. It needs a lot of commitment and continuous working. It's not also sometimes your own personal experiences. While it helps you as a mentor to have a lot of personal experiences, but unless and until you are somebody who goes other way around and sees a lot of data, a lot of time you spend, and then give your advice, it's a bit of a coaching, which is different from, you know, just bringing your own domain expert. You know, you need to be somebody who has to have ability to read better. You know, somebody who has the ability to go out and read better in businesses, somebody who has ability to understand the data better, would be able to have more analytic capabilities better, then only you can be a mentor. So even for mentors, I would say they have to really ask themselves, would they have enough time and commitment available? Are they also not somebody who's just put their own personal opinions on things? Because that doesn't work, because every single business and a business owner is very, very unique. So you cannot just go out and make your own personal opinions on this. I have been involved in a lot of mentorship programs, and I used to do that. I will be very honest, and I will go and make same opinions because of my own understanding of businesses, but I've stopped it completely. If anybody asks for advice from me, I will say, feed me a lot of data. The only thing I can tell is that I have ability to read that data and tell you where it stands. And that becomes that I'm not a judgmental on my own opinions, and I'm actually going by a very methodical approach, a more scientific approach towards guiding somebody. So it's a very important decision when you do that. And why? That's why most of the times your close relationships fail as being mentors. Your friends, family, they are not the greatest mentors. Why? Because they would not be able to give you impartial feedback. Their advice would be always some form of biased nature, and they would not be backed by a strong data and a factful experience. So all this would not be available. So sometimes, you know, your close relationships and close people in the family are not the best sometimes to take as a mentors, because they would not be able to give you, they would always be partial about some kind of feedback to you. And that something is not good, because the whole purpose you're taking a mentor is very, very important. So you need to really see what is the kind of impact you're looking for this program. That's very important. How is there a deeper reasons why you are taking this mentor? That's also very important. Why you want to really take a mentor? Because you need to really have some kind of a deeper reason. It's just not that you have a startup and you really want to engage somebody as a mentor. You need to really see what is the deeper reasons. And you also have to know your strength areas, weak areas, the areas where you need really help, and so on and so forth. And both sides have to have a very strong objectivity before they commit to this relationship. That's very, very important. So now let's get into the types of mentors. There are two types, and I've realized that there are two types very clearly, and one has to really see. You say, hey, I was developing a new product, or I needed some kind of ideation or innovation in that product. It happens in technology, it happens in typing. Then I need a mentor who comes very clearly a domain specialist, somebody who can guide me through in this. It's very, very, very similar to what happens in when you have a mentor in your education. Because if you are on a particular subject you're reading, you need somebody who has been a specialist on that subject who can guide you through that. It's very similar when you have a mentor when you're doing a PhD or doing any other thing. Very clearly you need a domain, because you will stuck at different stages and you need somebody to power it through for you. It improves your critical thinking. It improves your capability to solve problems. But you need to have somebody who clearly comes from a domain. So you need to really ask where you are. If you are somebody who is developing a new product or innovating something, you need to have somebody who is absolutely a domain specialist. Say I was doing a personal care product and I want to really take this into that. I need to go to somebody who understands personal care market deep down. And especially if it is a product which needs a little more engineering, then I need a product specialist, somebody who has the absolutely product specialist, and then take him as a mentor. So very clearly understand where your startup is. But if your startup was something which has some form of a product which has been already commercialized and now it's running as a business, and you need somebody who comes with a larger business experience and business reputation, or somebody who can help you open doors, open the network, and so on and so forth, then you need the second type of somebody who comes generally from a business experience on being an entrepreneur, very successful, and do that. So very clearly ask yourself where your startup is and where you need to do that thing. So there are two types of very clearly mentors to be in the market. One are very, very clearly domain champions. They would help you to address your business where it stages. Now let's get into the why. What are the stages of this mentorship program? You know, to me, any business would have to pass through four stages. And four stages, there are very few times I've realized that a mentor can actually help you all four. You might have to have different mentors at different stages. At the first stage, when you are pretty much at the what I call the validation of your business, you want to really have somebody who can help you to validate your business idea, take it to the next level, get even the business model validated in terms of that it would have a sustainability or a professional performance in going forward, which is more productization of your idea. So some form of, you need to really come down to a first stage. Second stage is what I call the incubation stage, where you need to really reach out to your audience. It's very clearly go to market and get your first success. Normally these two stages, I think, should be ideally done by one single mentor. And then third is a little different stage. It needs a scale. It needs somebody who has seen that. You know, people who are very clearly domain-based experience, they might help you in the first two stages, but not be able to scale this, because scale might need somebody who's seen it long-term, right? So somebody who has an ability to really go take this to from a certain size to a certain level, who has a very strong capability of driving what I call organizational design and also performances, monitoring and so on and so forth. And especially young founders, even if they get capitalized, I've seen that they get fail when they scale, because they have no ability to understand how large organizations would be run. So it becomes very overwhelming for somebody who's just maybe a few years in experience in business and suddenly has to manage a 1,000-member team. So how do you really get to a level where you have somebody along with you who can guide you through in this process? And fourth is where you need to really, what I call, monetize your startup, which means that you need to look at an exit or look at a you know, some kind of a capitalization for the business. So that stages are there. So I would say, I would split this into two parts, which is a little more mature side of things. And then the first is very clearly validation and incubating of your business model. So that's how your structure would work. Now let's get into what I call the nine reasons why a mentorship would work. You know, why would a mentor would be able to help your business? So first, it is essential when you're starting as a startup, it would be good to have a mentor, because you will save a lot of time to really go to the market. And that time, I think, can take a lot of serious you know, pain areas, because it's the most difficult time, especially if you're not from that business and you're starting off that business. Say I was starting a business in healthcare and I have somebody who's already have that experience, and a lot of people start, and young people from technology backgrounds, they come into these domains and they don't have industry domains available. They don't understand healthcare, but they understand technology. So they understand that they're creating a product, but they need to have a good mentor who can align with them, understand, validate their product, and tell them a real practical issues on healthcare. They understand the industry, get some contacts, and then get into the market. So that's where I would strongly say you need to really, if you want to save your time and money and get to market fast, you need to have somebody who's a strong mentor along with you. Another thing which is would be the second point, the mentor helps you learn faster and also become more smarter on your database, because every single touch point or data point can be backed by a lot of other industry facts. And so they keep validating those facts. So you get a bouncing structure with your mentor, which can help you do that. Third, which is very, very important, I think the most important aspect of this is that we give access to their networks. So if you have a good industry mentor and you're getting into that industry, you would be able to quickly get into a lot of networks. It also would continue to refine and continue to improvise your strategy. So once you draw a strategy and a business plan, it needs improvisation much, much, many, many times in your cycle. It needs maybe every 60 days, go back to see that is the strategy working as per what we really thought. Improve on all the other touch points for your communication, any kind of communication, marketing, business strategy, that also would be able to do that. Another point which is very important is the financial acumen. This is where I think a good entrepreneur who has been successful in past would be a great advice. And I've seen the businesses, especially early startups, in the first 24 months do a lot of financial disasters. You know, so they do a lot of financial mistakes. They don't understand how to plan their budgeting. They don't understand how they really want to forecast, how they really want to really kind of build the sustainability in the network. And that's why we have many, many, many failures in startups. A lot of startups we've seen failing, and especially in this COVID period, we saw even more failing because they had no financial acumen. So this is the area which I would say a mentor gets a very, very important aspect. Also, another thing which is access to a lot of knowledge and external knowledge base. You know, so every time you have a new area to really do that, a good mentor with his experience and his own network and his understanding to ability to bring other parts of experience also can be a lot of other alignments in your business which you require can also be brought in. Another area which is very important is to continue to boost your emotional intelligence, your creative thinking. This is one of the areas which is actually more emotional in nature, because sometimes when you're starting a business, you almost every week you have an emotional rundown. You are not successful. You're not able to get that. So you keep your emotional balance and your creative thinking going up. You need a mentor, somebody who is along with you, appreciates what you've done, and also guides you through if you've not worked for you or it needs a change of strategy. That also is important. And finally, somebody would be able to help you to raise capital or carve out your exit strategy. And even at a certain stage, help you to get some more resources. That would be also done by the mentor. Now, what is the objectivity? Why we really need a good mentor with us? I would say the three parts to this piece. One is accountability. You know, when you are a founder of a business, nobody really comes to you. You are the boss of the company while you run a small, boutique business, but it still is your company. You have no accountability. And especially early stage founders are not having the structured boards. You know, when you're running a large company, then you have a board, you become accountable to board. Every CEO, every business owner has to go back to the board to take a lot of decisions. But when you're running your own startup, you have nobody to really go to. Apart from if you have got some early investment, maybe you're investors, but you don't have a day-to-day accountability. So first, very important aspect is put yourself in the shoes where you think that there is somebody you are accountable for. And morally, you are responsible on taking those decisions. And once you've taken the decisions, going back and telling what happened on those decisions is very, very important. And that works very well. I mean, I think self-accountability is really very important in this business, and mentors will be from that. Second is to everything becomes process oriented. It is very important. And when you are early stage startup, you don't really put too much of time in setting some processes, but mentors help you to set those processes, because that would be, I think, more foundational so that you tomorrow when you start scaling up the business will be done. And third thing, which I would say most important aspect of a good mentor is that he's a rainmaker. He knows when you need help. When you need help, he's always around with you and helps you out to really get some kind of not necessarily just the funding, but it can be other resources which are required. So he's a rainmaker. He's somebody who's always around you and would be able to do that. Now let's get into what do you really need in a mentor? What are the reasons why you want to really do that? As I said, it's very important industry knowledge. Second, somebody who has an entrepreneurial edge on your business. He has some kind of you are starting your entrepreneurial journey now, but he's a little ahead of it. So he's able to see through a little more than what you're able to see through. He obviously brings in effective networks, but please make sure that I've seen a lot of mentors who have visibly a lot of network, but they don't open up. They don't open up. They feel shy to really share and do this and that. It takes a lot to really make some introductions. And at that stage, a lot of people I know don't do it. They would sound that they are available with you, but they will not make a conscious effort to really make one up their networks. And that's something is a very big differentiator. And that's why I keep saying this. Sometimes the big names which we see in the industry and people go to them and make them part of their organizations and treat them as mentors, they are not very effective. While they're sitting there as I think opens up some few doors for you, but they don't really pick up phones and open up their networks. I like people who might be, really seriously take their mentorship structures and their mentees, and they would not mind opening up their networks and so on. A fourth, which is very, very important, is chemistry. you know, a mentor and a mentee has to have a very strong chemistry. They need to really understand where each other is coming from, and they enjoy each other's success. And that's very, very important. And finally, he has to be a strong problem solver. You know, because the whole idea of having a mentor is that somebody who has the ability to solve your problem whenever it arises to do that. So how do you really make sure that you select a mentor? Really ask frank questions, understand what kind of availability he would have, what kind of time he can contribute, set some kind of schedules. It's very important. You need to really set some kind of a schedule that there would be so many hours in a month where you will be able to get that kind of entire thing. You are also able to get regular feedbacks. That's very important. Sometimes the physical meeting would not happen, but you can send data. You can get some kind of a strong, but well-read, well-understood feedbacks. And that's also very, very important. And also understand what is the length. What are you committing to this mentorship program? Because it can become a little bit of a difficulty later to really, when you start that program, then you become very difficult if you're not satisfied. Especially for founders, it becomes very difficult to start exiting from that relationship. So you need to really define what do you really want to achieve, at what stage you want to really do that. More you are respectful for defining it in the initially, more it will be easier for you to take through this whole program. And finally, what mentors normally would do, and I've seen a lot of people do it because they just want to help youngsters and they want to help new startups and they want to really do that. I think now it's the mature part of it. It should be very well defined. There is normally a advisory equity, which you should, as a startup, offer to your mentor. If you really select one and you think that there would be somebody who would be with you for next 3, 4, 5 years, and you need that contribution, and you can clearly see the kind of time that thing. Once you have done that, I would say absolutely offer some kind of a small equity. It can be anything from a 1% to 3-4%. Depending on the role and the time and effort for the mentorship. And because you do that, they're more involved. And sometimes that's not very defined, and that's where it goes wrong. So you need to really make sure that you go and offer as a startup to your mentor and say, this is what I would like to offer and take your mentorship, and this is what your expectation is. So remember, it is very, very important decision to have somebody who stays with you, helps you out, is a great problem solver, he's a rainmaker for you, and also somebody who is ahead of you to see through what is happening. So that's where the opportunity of making somebody to guide you through and making him a mentor for you would work. So this was today's session. Hope you are able to get something out of it. Now I'd like to invite Sonali back. If she has some questions, I can answer that.
Sure. Thank you so much for another wonderful session, Gaurav sir. We do have quite a few questions lined up with us already, so I would just take them up. The first question I would like to take up is, what is the difference between a mentor, a coach, and a consultant?
A good question. So I think while there are fine lines between all of them, but let me start with a consultant. And consultant is somebody who's normally very clearly a process somebody who will fix your processes. So they come with, say, if you have a supply chain problem, or you have a marketing problem, or you have an HR problem, if you have a technology problem. So you will hire a specialist who would come and fix that part of it. They normally don't look at the business at large. Normally they would fix the problem entirely. So those are consulting. They're most of the times what you pay them as a fee, and against that fee, they would do that. Coaching is a little more personal. It's more connecting the dots. Normally, it would work on various aspects to get larger results, which you are looking to expect from dieting. And mentor is even more ahead of it, where somebody who has a much deeper interest in your performance and so on and so forth. Coaching is a little more getting still in the business kind of a role. A mentor is a little more on the business kind of a role, where somebody who's looking at a larger picture for you and helping you to get there.
Absolutely, sir. The next question I would like to take up is, as you said, just getting a big name as a mentor or a board member is not really helpful. But as you can see in today's startups, most of them just get a big name to showcase that he or she is associated to their startup. In your opinion, does it add any real value to that startup?
It helps. I told in the last I think couple of I think we one of the companies we advised got Ratan Tata as a investor or a mentor in that, and just Ratan Tata sitting there in that company helped this company to really get all investors investing on that. And it's not the big investors, but micro investors who wanted to buy their franchise, they would, because they would all see Ratan Tata being there, they would all go out and queued up to take a share of that company. So it helps, you know, not everybody is Ratan Tata, not everybody is Bansals, and not everybody is very successful. We have very, very handful of people who are very successful and build unicorns or large corporations and so on and so forth. And Ratan Tata is a very exceptional example. He genuinely have a desire to help people and help their businesses to grow, which also carries risk with him because of looking at his personality and his size and his aura and his industrial capability. It can be very risky because he can, but if by the time he's doing it in a good spirit, everybody understands where he's coming from. But if you just take it only for the reason of that, if somebody like that, it helps. But I would say if you really want a mentor, you need to have somebody who's available for you. He's available and he's giving you genuine advice. Because I know the mistakes startups do in the first 2 to 3 years. And those mistakes can be saved. And businesses can be saved if you have a good mentor. Who also have time availability. You know, it's unreasonable for anybody to even expect Ratan Tata giving time on businesses to really look at your balance sheet, to understand what has happened on the business. He can be a God figure who can come in and bless you with he being available. But he is not going to be available for really putting that time and energy. And maybe it would not match because the businesses he's seen from the way he's seen, and the corporations he's run, he might not be the best right person to really advise a early stage startup. But there are, I would say, good, successful, good mentors out there who've done, you know, few past businesses, sold them on success or a profit. These are great mentors. And these people are really very, very good one. Another thing you need to really see that some mentors, I think they do overdo themselves. So they're advising many, many companies and they're advising or mentoring many businesses. So it means that they've overloaded. They have too much of work going on. And so find somebody who has availability for you and he likes you and he likes your business. And that's very important.
Absolutely, sir. The next question is, what are the various reasons mentors work for? Money or share in a business or just to share their experience? What kind of a mentor or a coach should we choose as an early stage business?
Coaches would work for money. They're monthly paid. So this coaching is a profession. It's a professional advisory or coaching business where you pay them monthly fee. I feel that if you are not very sure that somebody can act as a mentor and you feel that it can be a better coach, it's better best for the business. Because you paid it, you're not locked in, you have no long-term commitment, because sharing an equity with somebody is a very, very long-term commitment. And it also can be questioned by when the future investors start coming in and if sees that this person is holding 3%, they would like to ask question that why you know, this was given and what value he or she brought in. So I would say if you don't see that long-term viewpoint, then don't take them in a mentor. Maybe somebody is a better coach and pay a fee or a monthly retainer to work and get that. Sometimes, you know, young startups really don't appreciate their equity so much. So they feel that reserving cash is more important. So they give away equity much likely, you know, and that's not good. And but if you want a mentor, I would say mentors largely, there are two types. I would have to say one genuinely want to help founders and help companies. They do mentoring depending on their time. It gives them refreshing. They just feel that this is their way of contributing back. A lot of them do it. Jack Ma has mentored many, many, many entrepreneurs in China. I know one of his mentees who started $1 billion a shoe company. They make shoes and an eyewear company. The two products they have, and he built this. Mentored him and he's a 31-year-old young Chinese guy and who built a $1 billion company in eyewear and shoes. Again, directly mentored by the he has a big class, which Jack Ma used to do every year. He will bring in a lot of people, but he never takes equity interest on positions in these companies. He used to do it purely by his way of doing, giving back to society and giving back to entrepreneurship. But this is only done at a level of Jack Ma's and likes of them. They do it for that. But rest, every mentor would expect a certain small equity in the business, which is good. You should really give that equity. Rather, if somebody is shying away from not asking, go and ask openly and say, this is what my expectation would be, that I would like you to have a small equity in my company and mentor me through this whole thing. But don't just rush it. Just because it's a big name or a fancy name you want to give somebody an equity has no meaning to me unless and until you very clearly define what is an expectation alignment.
Right. And on very, very similar lines, we have quite a few questions with us asking us about what are the most prevalent engagement models and commercial terms in India, or how do we fix fees with a mentor? Anything you would like to add on to that?
Anything which is 1% to 4-5% is, that's the high. 4-5% again, I would say it's very high. Conserve your, you know, your equity. It's very, very important. It's very prestigious and should not be given just for sake of it. And also define who you really need, you know, why you need a mentor, what mentor is going to do. You know, I've seen, you know, why one of the companies I was advising, and I asked that, and he said that I have a chef who's my mentor. I said, why you have a chef as a mentor? He said, no, because I wanted a phenomenal product and he was guiding me. I said, you would have hired him because product development was only one time. Why would you have somebody sitting as an equity who is not a complete understanding of running a full chain? Because product development was just part of it. It was phased. I understand it was important. And he said, no, he would have not worked with me on that stage, but I wanted him to guide me and mentor me. And I asked the same question. I said, what do you expect now? He says, very little. Only 3 months, he comes and improves my product and sees what is going on. So don't really confuse between fixing your different processes. For that, you need consultants or coaches are available. But mentor is somebody who is for a little long period and a much holistic approach to this rather than just being advertising. And emotionally, most important thing, which I think which is always underwritten, is your emotional balance. And that emotional balance, it comes best with a mentor, you know, and somebody who questions you a lot. And I had in my initial days a dear friend of mine, which I treat him as my mentor. And he was an Australian. He's Australian, lives in now in Australia. And that time he was in India. The one thing which I liked about him, he was every time he'd come to me and he just has hundreds of questions for me, you know, and I will get on to like a school kid giving him answers on why this did and why didn't that thing and why would you do this and why would you not do that. And he took me always through a self-discovery, and I used to feel that every time he left, and I used to feel what he gave me, nothing. But I started realizing that he was best because he really put my critical thinking. He questioned me what I was trying to do and why I was trying to do. And that made me much more smarter to take my own decisions. So that's something which you need to really find. Who's this person in your life and who's this, you know, and everything. And that's where I would say these are smaller pieces which are more important to me rather than somebody opening up a strategy box and saying, oh, here is a strategy, go out and do it. That's not something which I think is an ideal mentorship.
Right, sir. I'll just take up the last few questions now. Another question that we have is, should I get different mentors for different fields like technology, marketing, sales, etc.? Where can I find a mentor who can guide me in all these aspects?
Sorry, I missed your point.
Should I get different mentors for different fields like technology, marketing, sales? Where can I find a mentor who can guide me in all of these aspects?
So again, you have to find out what is the most critical part of it. Again, as I said, types of mentors. If you are at the product development stage, the most critical is to get your product right, validate the product. So that piece would be, I think, would be more important to fix. And as your business goes to a little bit of what I call the organization scale and developing smaller pieces of your organization, then you might need somebody who comes with a larger canvas of understanding business. But don't overdo yourself with so many mentors at one point in time, because you just need one good mentor and that's about it. But you need to define where you are in business and who would be the more right fitment for you. And that's something which is
Sure, sir. So lastly, we just have questions from people who are asking us about where they can actually find a mentor. So many questions regarding that. So anything you would like to add on to that?
It's around you. You know, if whatever business you have started, there are people who are successful in that. You need to really go out and reach out to them actively, meet them, set them entire perspective, offer them that, look, I'm looking for that. I think don't sound them that they are the ones who are looking at it. Initiate a dialogue and see if their business and you fit them, and their willingness is there for that entirely for you. And if you want to really reach out, even Business X is a big platform where we link you with a couple of industry people in different structures. So you reach out to Sonali and she would be happily able to send you some contacts or some mentors in. But you tell us which industry you want and who you want and things of that nature, we will be more than happy to do that.
Definitely, sir. So with this, we'll just wrap up the Q&A session. Thank you so much once again, Gaurav sir, for another insightful session and for very patiently answering all of our questions as always. Anything you would like to say in the end?
I saw one question. It says, what is the organization as a mentor or a franchise selection guide? Yeah. So we don't do. I do it sometimes on a personal capacity. And some of my senior team members also do it. But we as an organization are multifaceted, but largely a SME solution company. Franchising is one part of it, but we run licensing, we run Business X, a business resale, and a business investment banking outfit. And then we have media, but everything we do is around SME. So we understand SME as a large thing, the startup to SME, the whole space, we understand pretty well. And anything which we can service this community is done by a Franchise India group. So if I've answered your question right. So if you have anything which you want to really present in terms of your startup, which you want to raise capital, or you want to exit your business, or you want a mentor, or you need help doing some collaboration, joint venture, or M&A opportunity, please reach out to Sonali. And she's working hard to organize these webinars for me to come and say that, look, if you want any services from Sonali, you should go to her and take all the services. Okay. Thank you very much. Hope this was helpful for you. Any subject you would like me to share. I'm enjoying this because I feel that this gives me opportunity to touch on topics which are not regular for us. In our business advisory and things of that nature, we're always busy in doing whatever we're doing. So it gives me also an opportunity to really interact. And sometimes some of you write back to me and I get an opportunity to know your businesses. It's also very good. And I've realized that the next set of entrepreneurs would be very, very young, and they would come extremely young. And it will not be surprising for me that the next billion-dollar companies will be made by people who are 19 and 18 and likes of them. They're pure in thinking, and more pure you are, more your chances are that you will think of a genuine problem and try to solve a genuine problem rather than just being somebody who's just a follower. So we are coming a long way because I would say how we were trained and raised and educated created a situation that we became a good followers rather than innovators. So as we are coming off that hangover, which was 300 years of our hangover of told that this is the only way things are done. I think India would see a lot of critical thinking, innovation would start coming in. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, once again. And thank you to all our attendees. We really hope we were able to add some value to your lives through this session. And as Gaurav sir said, if you need any help, if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to me. And we'll see you next time, next Saturday at 3 p.m. with another session in our series of investment, scaling up, valuation, and exiting a business.
My email ID is gm@gauravmaria.com. So please reach me if I can be of any help.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, everyone.